It's my honor to introduce Mitchel Whitington.
Wow, I really appreciate it. It's such a pleasure to be here at the Allen Public Library, and I'd like to just take a second and thank Tom and the whole crew here at the library. It's amazing to me as I've been looking into what they've been doing and all the different programs that here in the middle of a pandemic, they can keep the information flowing to the city and to the public. It's just an amazing job you guys are doing. So, Tom, thank you so much. And I appreciate the invitation to come talk to you today. I'm going to get to talk about something I really enjoy talking about, and that is the supernatural. It's something I have been interested in my entire life, since I was just a wee lad. I don't know what started it. I don't know what sparked that interest, but it's something that I have always just been fascinated by. So when I became a writer, it was natural for me to start writing about haunted places, and I've been doing that for, 20 years now. And it's been quite an interesting time. I've never spoken at the Allen Library before, so since I am new here, I thought I would take the opportunity to go and get a handful of haunted stories for you. Some of the most interesting things that I've run across in my career. They are quite interesting, and I hope that you enjoy them. We're going to be bopping around the country and talking about different things that have happened over the years. But I want to start right here in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. You know, people always ask me, when you go and you are going to be investigating a place that you're going to write about, do you have all this fancy electronic equipment? Do you have all these gadgets like you see on TV? Or do you have special cameras that are infrared and night vision and all these different things? How do you do this? And I tell people, well, it may surprise you to learn that the most effective tool that I have in my ghost hunting toolbox is a library. Just like we're in right now. I find that doing research on the places that I'm going to be writing about can often tell me a lot about them. It can really open the door to what might be going on there, who might be coming back, and why. Case in point, we're going to go to a place right here in the Metroplex, over in the Deep Ellum section of Dallas. There's a nightclub called the Lizard Lounge. I wrote about it in the Ghost of North Texas book, and in fact, I was starting to kind of do research on different places around the North Texas area. Now, I was going through old newspapers and magazines and looking for any leads on what places might have some ghost stories, and I saw a mention that the Lizard Lounge, this nightclub, might have some ghost stories associated with it. So I contacted them just to see. Now, I kind of have a hard, fast rule. I will never out a place as being quote-unquote haunted unless they give me their permission or unless they have spoken about it publicly before. So in this case, I didn't have either one of those, so I just cold called them and said who I was and what I was doing. I said, would it be okay if I talked to you about some possible ghost stories at your place? They said, sure, no problem. Come on down, take a look. They said, but the person you really need to talk to is this young lady, and they gave me her name. So we set up a time when we could talk, and we got together, and she didn't know much about the building before it became the Lizard Lounge. She didn't really have any information prior to that, but she had a lot of good stories about the place. She said, it's an old building, I know. She gave me several wonderful ghost stories that she had personally experienced. Probably my favorite was, she said that the last thing they do, when it's time to shut down, they flip on all the lights, they get everybody herded out the front door, and then before they lock up, they'll walk around going room to room to room, and you know, in the dressing rooms, the bathrooms, the main hallway there, the stage. By the way, the Lizard Lounge has a wonderful stage area. That's the outside of the building. If you look inside, it's got a beautiful crystal chandelier hanging in the middle of it. It also has a stage on one side. So there's just a wonderful atmosphere there. But she had proceeded to tell me that they were closing up one night. She went on her appointed rounds, making sure there was nobody left in the building. And when she walked into that main club area, she said, on the stage, I kind of got a glimpse of a man. He was walking up the steps on the side. He was wearing a dark suit, and he had an old hat on. She said, now, that didn't surprise me. She said, it would amaze you what people wear to the nightclub. But she said, I saw that, and I turned around and yelled at the other guys, hey, we still got somebody here. So she said, I followed the direction he had gone. I went up the steps, you know, went to the back there, couldn't find him. He was nowhere to be found. I went out, and the other folks had come up by then and said, we're missing a guy. I saw him. He was right here. They turned the place upside down. They completely went through every square inch looking for this guy and never found him. She said, Mitch, I got to tell you, the only explanation I have, it had to be a ghost. And I said, wow, that's kind of interesting. I appreciate that. Well, I started doing research on the building itself, and this is getting into what I was saying earlier. Research to me really can uncover some wonderful things. It certainly did in this case. So I started looking back into its past, and I found out the building used to be a theater where they did plays. And it was named after that big crystal chandelier you saw in the picture. They called it, I believe the name of it was something like the Crystal Chandelier. But and looking through the kind of things they did there, I found the website for an actress. And she had done a number of productions at that theater. She lived in California now. So I contacted her by email. I told her who I was and what I was doing. I said, would you possibly consent to an interview? And she said, oh, yes, I'd love to. She's very nice. We talked on the phone for I don't know how long, but she was so thrilled to learn that the place was still in operation, albeit not as a theater, but as a nightclub. But she said, is the chandelier still there? And I said, yes, it is. And she was so happy about that. She had wonderful memories of the place. So we got to talking, and she told me another ghost story or two from her past there. But then she said, you know, probably the most interesting thing that happened to me was one afternoon I got the key so I could go and start rehearsal early. I had a musical number in a play. So I was going to go and, you know, do it from the stage so I could get the acoustics down and everything. She said, so I was there by myself. I'd lock the front door so nobody could come in. And as I'm on one part of the stage, some movement caught my eye. And I turned, and going up the stairs onto the stage was a man. He had a dark suit on, and he had an old-fashioned hat. And her first thought was, oh, my gosh, I left the front door open. She said, so I hollered at him, hey, excuse me, but he had already moved on. So she went back there, couldn't find him anywhere. She looked all through the theater. She even went back up front and saw that she had, in fact, locked the door. No way anybody could have got in. She says, you know, the only explanation I have is it had to be a ghost. And I thought, you don't know the half of it. What she had just described is the same thing that this young lady described. Now, you have to understand that the young lady had no idea of the building's past. This actress living in California had no idea of what the building was now. These two ladies were a generation apart. They were half a continent apart. Yet, they described the exact same occurrence in that building. So I had a police officer that read Ghost of North Texas after it came out, and he said, you know, I got to tell you, my favorite story, hands down, is the one about the Lizard Lounge. And I said, really? Why is that? He said, I'm a police officer. He says, in my world, if I can have two witnesses, independent witnesses, to describe a crime scene, and a person there exactly the same, that's enough to get a conviction on. He said, there are people sitting in prison right now on the same level of evidence that you got in your book about this ghost. And I thought, wow, that's kind of neat. I like that. I usually am not one that goes out and tries to prove anything to anybody. It doesn't matter to me what people believe and what they don't. But here in this one little chapter I wrote in this Ghost of North Texas book, I seem to have at least enough evidence to have convinced this police officer that, wow, maybe there is something to this. Well, moving on, you know, I get the question quite a bit, have you ever been scared? And I have been so blessed. I've gotten to travel from one end of the country to the other, staying at old haunted inns and eating at these ancient restaurants with all these ghost stories going back, you know, far into the past. And it's really been a truly fantastic experience. I am just so blessed. But that question comes up a lot. Have you ever been scared? And I have to say, yep. One time I was, and it wasn't too far from here. It was a place near Jacksonville, Texas, and it's just kind of south of Tyler. there's a place there called the Kilo Monument. Now, it is the site of a massacre that occurred, and this was back in 1838, and there was a few families trying to settle the land, and they were at odds with the Native Americans in the area. So they left because they were afraid, but they came back just in time to harvest their crops, and a band of renegade Native American guys came up, and it was a massacre. 18 people were either killed or kidnapped. So they later, when the bodies were discovered, they buried them at this place, put a cemetery together. And then in the 1930s, the WPA, they came and they built an obelisk. It's right there. This is the Kilo Monument area. You can see the graves. You can see the obelisk. It's really kind of interesting. But they fenced it in. And now there's a Kilo family organization that keeps it up and pays to have it mowed and things like that. So I had heard that a lot of weird things went on there. So I decided to go pay a visit to it myself. Now, I'm really careful when I'm writing about cemeteries. Cemeteries are hallowed ground. I treat them with complete and total respect. I encourage people to do the same. If you go visit to, you know, a cemetery for whatever reason, you have to realize it is a place of rest for all these people, and it should be treated as such. I tell people, don't ever take anything out of a cemetery, and don't leave anything behind. What's that old saying? Take only photos and leave only footprints. And I very much am a believer in that. So when I went to this one, I was being very respectful, but I was walking around, and I was reading the different plaques and things they had out. They had a historical marker there. They had, you know, the plaque on the obelisk that was dedicating it to the Kilo family. And so I spent some time there walking around. I was taking a lot of pictures. I was making notes. And the longer I was there, the more I felt like I was not alone. I mean, I felt like somebody was watching me. You know, I could just almost feel it. I was telling a group one time, if I were to take you into a big gymnasium, turn off all the lights and put you in a chair in the center and then leave, and at some point tiptoe back in sock feet, as soon as I got near you, you'd be able to feel that there was somebody there. That's exactly the way I felt in that cemetery. And I felt like I wasn't really welcome. It was kind of an angry feeling, and I thought, man, am I upsetting somebody? I'm not doing anything wrong. But the longer I was there, the worse I felt about it. So at one point, it got so intense that I said, okay, I think I've got enough. I think I can go home now. And I started walking back to the car. With every step, I was getting a little bit faster and a little bit faster. By the time I got back to the car, I was in a dead run. I jumped in the car and hit the door locks and then started laughing, going, what good is that going to do? But anyway, I was in the car, so I felt better. I left, and I put that in a book called Ghosts of East Texas in the Pineywoods. So this cemetery is extremely hard to find. It's out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, it's really tough to get to if you don't have exact directions. So I had put exact directions in that book. And about a year later, I was going to go do a talk for some organization and, you know, do some book signings. And so I was on my way, and I happened to be going through Jacksonville. I looked and I saw the road that is the first turnoff that you get on to go to the Kilo Cemetery, the Kilo Monument. So I thought, you know, I'm running kind of ahead of schedule. I could spare a few extra minutes. So I'm going to go just check it out and see if it's got that same feeling. I found it right away. Once you have been there, you can kind of recognize the landmarks to get you back. But I got there and I got out of the car, and it was one of the most peaceful places I had ever seen. I mean, walking around, I just felt complete calm, complete peace. Everything was fine. And looking back, I have to think that maybe I was seen the first time as an interloper. What is this guy doing here? What does he want? Why is he taking all these pictures? Whatever presence was there, I think, didn't like the fact that I was poking around, as respectful as I was being. But the second time, maybe they kind of sensed the fact that, all right, I had treated it with respect and everything was okay, because I just felt welcome there, and I would go back again in a heartbeat. So when people ask me, have you ever been scared? I can't say no. I have to say, yep, that one time, I was terrified. Now, I'll have to tell a story on my wife, because she had an event one evening that was, I guess it kind of shook her up a little bit. I was writing a book called A Ghost in My Suitcase, A Guide to Haunted Travel in America. Had this great idea. My idea was I was going to pick one haunted place in every state, and visit it, write about it, and then put it in this book. And so I sold the idea to a publisher. They said, go ahead. We signed a contract. And I saw some wonderful places. I mean, we traveled a lot. It was just really interesting putting this book together. But we had gone up to Wyoming. Well, there we go. The town of Cody, Wyoming. It's a place up there called the Irma Hotel. This is the Irma. And the Irma was built by Buffalo Bill Cody. Now, Buffalo Bill Cody had a Wild West show, and he would travel around and put on the show all around the country. But he would do it during the spring, summer, and fall. In the winter, it was too cold for everybody to be outside and watch this Wild West show. So in winter, he needed a place to kind of hunker down and spend some time working on new acts and polishing the ones he had. So he founded this town of Cody, Wyoming. He also built a hotel there. He wanted to have this wonderful hotel that was going to be a show place. He built it in 1902. He named it after his daughter, Irma. So they built the Cody Hotel, and I mean the Irma Hotel, rather. And it has this wonderful bar downstairs. Of course, it has its ghost stories as well. Supposedly, there's a gunslinger that people have seen walking up the stairs, and footsteps that just walk along an empty hallway. So, well, we had to go. I said, this is going to be my place for Wyoming. The Irma Hotel is it. So we booked far enough in advance that we could actually get Colonel Cody's suite. Now, it was on the second floor. It had a really sizable balcony. And the story was that he would sit out on the balcony when it was audition time, and the people would get it in the street and do their auditions for the Wild West show. So it was kind of a great story to go into the whole episode with. But we checked in the hotel. There's the steps where they say the gunslinger walks up and down. And we went into the Cody suite, the Buffalo Bill Cody suite. And it was really a nice place. It was a great room. We just loved it. But my wife hadn't been there 5 minutes before she turned around and said, there's something wrong. I can't stay here. And I said, well, what do you mean? She said, we have to leave. I can't stay in this room. And I said, why? It's a great room. Look, it's nice. She said, no. She said, there's something here that doesn't like me. It doesn't want me. It's a female presence. It's like the spirit of a woman that resents the fact that I'm here. They don't want me here. I can't stay here. And I was like, oh, come on. You're just tired from traveling. I don't feel anything weird. It feels like a wonderful, warming place. I love it. This is a great room. It's got a great balcony. Come on. And she's like, I just don't think I can do this. I mean, well, we're in the middle of Wyoming, so we don't have a lot of choices. And we've already paid for the room. Come on. We've got to stay here. She said, all right, we'll try. Well, over the next few hours, weird things started happening to her, and I kept trying to explain it. Like, she was standing in the doorway looking out into the balcony there, and the door slammed in her face. She said, hey, did you see that? And I said, well, Tammy, that was the wind. Come on. Don't be so weird about this. Obviously, the wind just blew it closed. Well, later on, she was taking a shower. I heard her yell out, and I ran in there. Are you okay? She said, somebody turned the hot water off. It's just freezing cold all of a sudden. And I said, well, maybe the pipes in this hotel are older than both of us put together. Of course the water's, you know, probably the next door neighbor, you know, turned on the water, flushed the toilet or something like that. Obviously. And as I'm explaining this away, the faucet right beside us turns on. Now water is running in the sink. And I stood there looking at it while she said, okay, explain that one. I said, all right. Well, I said, let's just give it a shot. Come on. Well, later in the evening, we had gone out on the balcony, and you can see the main drag there in Cody, and we watched the whole town shutting down and watched the sun going down. It was really beautiful. And we had stopped, and we picked up a bottle of wine, and we had a couple of plastic wine glasses. mean, you have to make certain concessions in the middle of Wyoming, but we had these plastic wine glasses and we'd poured wine and we're sitting there talking and I'm looking at her, we're having a conversation and I'm looking right at her. And as I am, something slapped the wine glass out of her hand and it was skittering across the floor. And I don't mean she dropped it. I don't mean it slipped out. I mean, I saw something knock it out of her hand. And she said, "That's it. I'm done. Okay, pack up. Let's go." And I was like, "Well, no, just wait. Where are we going to go? Come on. Let me try one thing." So I thought about it a second, and I went back into the room, and I stood there, and I said, "Okay, I don't know who is here, but if you would, just give me a second. We're here just to stay in the room for the evening. It is, after all, a hotel. So if you don't mind, could you please not bug my wife anymore? Could you just kind of leave her alone? I assure you, we mean nothing but respect. We've got nothing but respect for the building, the room, for you. But we need a place to spend the night. So if you will just leave us alone in the morning, I promise you, we're going to get in the car and leave. We've only booked for one night. So we'll be out of your hair. You'll probably never see us again." So I didn't get any special signs or anything like that. And I thought, well, whatever. I went back out and my wife had been listening out on the patio. She said, "Well, did it work?" And I said, "I don't know. I hadn't had a problem since I got here." She walked back in the room and she said, "You know, it feels different in here. Everything's okay. You know, whatever you did, I guess it worked. I think I can spend the night here. It's all right." We had an uninterrupted night's sleep. Everything was perfect. We checked out the next day. And sure enough, I got a wonderful chapter to go in my Ghost in My Suitcase book. Well, you know, the other thing I tell people, and as you heard during the introduction, my wife and I have a house in Jefferson, Texas. It's called The Grove, and it's an 1861 home. The ghost stories go back at least 100 years that we've been able to trace, and it's a tour home. Jefferson, by the way, is a wonderful little town. It's got these brick streets, and there's carriage rides and bed and breakfasts and antique stores, and a lot of the older homes in town are tour homes. You can actually tour them, and ours is one of those, although we don't just have history. We have some ghost stories to share with our guests as well. So people ask me all the time, "Hey, on the tour, is anything going to happen to us?" And I say, "Well, I don't know. I have no idea. I mean, you know, it's really not that kind of arrangement. You know, they're not here to entertain. They're not here to, you know, do things on command. It's kind of a being at the right place at the right time kind of situation." That's what I tell people. And I have said that so many times before. You know, they are not here at our whims. They don't just answer to our, you know, requests. So, you know, if they're at the right place at the right time, you might experience something. Well, that whole thing got turned around on me when we went to Estes Park, Colorado. It's a wonderful hotel called the Stanley. Now I was working on the Ghost in My Suitcase book, and that was going to be my Colorado location. And the Stanley, if you've ever heard of it, it's a beautiful big hotel up in the mountains, just right outside of Rocky Mountain National Park. It was the hotel that inspired Stephen King to write the book The Shining. If you've never read The Shining, please read the book. Don't rent the movie. Read the book. It's outstanding. But he was inspired to write that book from staying in the Stanley Hotel. And in fact, you can rent the room that he stayed in where the things happened that made him go ahead and write that book. So it's a wonderful place. And it was opened in 1909 by F.O. and Flora Stanley. They had gone up into the mountains to live because they thought that the mountain air would do them well. And I guess it did. They ended up building this huge hotel up there. F.O., his favorite thing to do was to hang out in the billiards room. He would go down there and get games going, you know, with some of his guests. While Flora loved music, she would play the piano. They had a whole music room for Flora. Oh, both the billiards room and the music room are there today, and you can visit them. And the Stanleys do show up today in the billiards room. Occasionally, they've seen a man in there and in turn, and nobody was there. They've smelt his cigar smoke. You know, he seems to still be hanging out in the billiards room. Well, Flora hangs out in the music room. My wife and I were walking through, and she went over to look at the grand piano, and she said there was this incredible sensation of flowers. She said it smelled like she had walked into a garden. And she said it was so pronounced that she went and talked to somebody from the hotel and said, what happened to me back there? Do y'all put some kind of sense out or something? They go, no, that was Flora. When she comes back, she manifests by giving the scent of flowers. So my wife had experienced that. But anyway, we decided to go ahead and take a tour of the place. So we were on a tour with a few other people and a tour guide. We went all through the hotel. And by the way, let me show you the hotel. Magnificent place, isn't it? It is, but they have several buildings. They have a music hall where back in the old days they would put on performances, and they would have pianists to come up and give concerts for the guests. It is well worth a visit, I have to tell you. But we explored the entire hotel itself, and then we went over to the music hall, which you see here. Now, going through, there's a big auditorium where the concerts would happen. Now they use it basically for weddings, wedding receptions, corporate events, things like that. But they still have all these other rooms, these rehearsal rooms and things like that. Our guide said, hey, let me show you something weird. I said, great, I'm always up for something weird. So we went to this one room, and she explained that the hotel would close down during the winters. It's just like this in the book, The Shining. That's where King got that. Because they got so much snow, the roads were impassable, you couldn't get supplies in and out, so they would just close down for the harsh winter months. And the hotel gets locked up. There was a passageway between the music hall and the Stanley Hotel. A girl named Lucy somehow got into the hotel while it was closed down, found her way into this passageway, and was accidentally locked in. Well, they found her body when they came back to start reopening the hotel, a young girl. And she, of course, it was locked in there in this severe temperatures with no water, no food. But the guy told us Lucy comes back and hangs down in the room that has the entrance to that passageway. And it's now locked, of course, but she said, watch this. So we all stood around in the room, and the door had been open since we walked in. Forgive me, I'm a writer, but I can't talk. Since we walked in, there you go, I got it. And the guide walked over to the door and stood a couple of feet from it and said, Lucy, please close the door. And my wife and I are looking at each other like, what? And sure enough, the door starts moving like this and closes, clicks. And I'm standing there going, no, it doesn't work like that. No, that's impossible. So she opened it up, and I said, come on now, really? I mean, I live in a haunted house, and nobody does anything I ask them to, living or dead. But she said, no, watch again. She said, Lucy, if you wouldn't mind, please close the door. The door starts moving again, closes. And the lady said, well, okay, I'm going to move on. So, and most everybody left, and my wife and I stayed behind with a couple other people. And this one guy decided he was going to figure this out. And I mean, he did everything but take the door off the hinges. He was looking for strings, for wires, for magnets, he was checking to see how it was, how it was hung and the balance of it. He could find nothing. And I said, well, let's see. So we opened the door. We stood back. I said, Lucy, could you please open the door? Could you please close the door? And the door again started swaying like that and closed. And I thought, okay, well, now I have to reevaluate the fact that they aren't doing things on demand for us. I just can't figure out how to get the people in my house, the spirits that live there, to respond to me like that. But that one place is worth a visit. I highly recommend going to the Stanley Hotel. Well, I'm going to move on and tell a story that is probably, of all the experiences I've had, one of the most powerful. Now, this will be interesting for everybody out there watching, because usually there's one point in the story I tear up. So I'm going to try not to do that. I'm going to try to work my way through it. But otherwise, yeah, get ready to laugh and make fun of me. I know. But here's what happened. I was writing this book, Ghost in My Suitcase, and I was coming with my deadline, in the just very near future. I was looking out going, wow, I've still got a lot of places to go. Well, not a lot, but a number of places to go. And my deadline is right here. So I'm going to have to call my editor. Picked up the phone. I called my editor and I said, look, we have a problem. the deadline is approaching, and I still got a number of places, and just logistically and physically, I just don't know if it's going to be possible to go to all these places and do all these things. I said, I guess I'm asking if we can push the deadline out a little bit. And she said, are you kidding me? No. I said, we've already got an editor schedule to start on it on the day you handed in, which is on this particular day right here. And then we've got somebody to come in afterwards to do the book layout. We're going to have the book artist doing the cover and all these things. Everybody is scheduled to do your book. If you delay it, it's going to throw everybody's schedule off. So I said, okay, we'll figure something out. And she said, but I've got an idea. She said, why don't you, the places you can't absolutely get to, call them on the phone, explain who you are, what you're doing, see if they'll work with you. And they can maybe interview you, and you can interview them, and they'll send you pictures and maybe even a video or two or something like that. You know, we live in a world that is now all connected, so why don't you try that? And I said, that's a great idea. So when it came down to my place for Minnesota, it was a place in Annandale, Minnesota called Thayer's Historic Bed and Breakfast Inn. So I called the place, I talked to the owner, Sharon Gamble, and I told her who I was. I'm writing this book, and she said, oh, we'd love to be in your book. That would be great. And I said, wonderful. So she was really easy to work with. She gave me all the information I needed. She sent me pictures. She, you know, was just extremely, extremely helpful to me. But you know, if you've read one of my books or any of my books, you know that when I'm writing about haunted places, the first thing I do is I tell the history of the place. Like I said a while ago, I find looking at the history of a place can, you know, really be a great asset when you're trying to figure out the supernatural activity there. So I'd gotten the history of the place and who had first built it and where it all came from. So I was talking to her another time and I said, I need some ghost stories. What happens with the ghost stories? She told me some of those. And I said, great. Do you have any amenities? And that's the other thing I put in the chapters about the places I'm writing about is if there's anything really super cool about the place, I want to be sure and enlist it and, you know, kind of give them a little shot as well. So, I said, do you have anything special about your place? She said, well, I'm psychic. I do readings for my guests. And I said, that's great. I'll put that in there. So I did. And we talked a few more times and I got a few more ghost stories from her. She said, one of the things that happens here is in one of the rooms, people find pennies. And she said, I clean the rooms. So, you know, I vacuum, I dust, I make the beds. There's certainly nothing in there when I'm leaving. And then when they check in, they'll find that there's a penny sitting in a very conspicuous place, like in the middle of the bed or right on the seal going into one of the rooms or on the dresser right in the middle of it. She said, places where it wasn't when I left the room. And I thought, huh, that's kind of interesting because that has happened to me my entire adult life. I find pennies and I find them at times when I am looking for some affirmation on a decision or, you know, something I've been thinking about and wrestling with. A penny always shows up at just the right time. And it's kind of become a joke between my wife and I when, you know, trying to figure something out. I go, found a penny today. So I told Sharon that. I said, it's so weird you say that because that happens to me. And I told her the story I just told you. And Sharon was quiet for a minute or two. And she said, you realize those are coming from your granddad. And I mean, it was just this whoosh of realization when I stopped and thought about the fact granddad used to give me pennies. Back in the day, you could get penny candy. You'd go into the store and they'd have these big bins of like banana toffee and bazooka gum. And you could buy pieces of candy for a penny. And he would always give me a penny and say, he called me Sonny Boy. Sonny Boy, go get you some penny candy. And I'd completely forgotten that. And she said, no, here he is. He's already passed on. He's on the other side, but he is watching over you and he is helping you by doing that. I thought, that is amazing. That is just pretty incredible. So I finished that book. That was it for my relationship with Sharon. I thanked her profusely. And, several years went by. I started on other projects. I started looking for, you know, different books to, exploring different books that I'm writing and different projects. And I didn't even think about Sharon or Thayer's Bed and Breakfast. And, you know, as time went by, we had an event that was very painful for my wife and I. My wife and I have always had basset hounds. I tell people that my life is going to be measured in Bassetts. We're currently on number 6 and 7 right now. They're both rescues. I guess Bella was walking down the side of a farm-to-market road. Her feet were all tore up and everything. She'd been on the road so long. Devereaux, somebody dumped in the parking lot at McDonald's. So we picked her up. So now they're both really spoiled. They're back home being spoiled by their mom right now. But just a few years after Ghost in My Suitcase came out, we had one Basset named Samantha. And we woke up one Sunday morning and Samantha was in physical distress. I mean, we could tell something was not just wrong with her, but bad wrong with her. And I told my wife, I said, I'm going to grab her. I'm going to take her to the doggy ER, which was in another city. The closest one we have is about 45 minutes away. So I drove her over there real quick. And as quickly as I could get there, and I'm in the waiting room because it was very crowded, and I'm holding her, and I could tell she was just really going. I mean, she was fading fast, and I went and told the nurse there, I said, I think that we're losing her. And so they let me go straight back there, and they put a ventilation tube down her throat, and the doctor was very sympathetic. He said, I there's just no good way to tell you this. She's gone. She probably went in your arms, and she's breathing by this tube right now. So once we take the tube out, it's over, but she's gone anyway. And I said, okay, I understand. And I wouldn't want to prolong anything like that. So they took the tube out and I arranged for, you know, her to be cremated and for us to get the ashes. And I went home, and boy, was that a bad Sunday. We cried. Oh, and now keep in mind, this is before social media. There was no Facebook. There was no Twitter. There was no Snapchat. So we didn't post anything on social media. Didn't have that ability back then. We told my parents, we told my wife's parents, and that was about the extent of it. We didn't want to make a big deal. We wanted to kind of grieve privately for a day or two, and we did that. And then I got an email out of nowhere from Sharon Gamble, the lady that has Thayer's Historic Bed and Breakfast that I put in the Ghost in My Suitcase book. And she said, what's wrong with you? There's something wrong in your life. I can't quit thinking about you. So I called her and I said, Sharon, how could you have known this? I said, this isn't going to make any sense, but we just lost one of our dogs and it's been devastating to us. It's been horrible. And we have just been crying our eyes out and grieving for Samantha. And she said, ah, that explains it. She said, because when I am thinking about you, I'm seeing three dogs as well. And that blew me away because she didn't know we had dogs. We'd never talked about my personal life at all or her personal life. We talked about her inn. We didn't have these big Facebook pages with all these things. There's no way she could have known that in our marriage, at that point, we had had three dogs that had passed, Fred, Murphy, and now Samantha. And she said, but I'm seeing three dogs, and one of them just passed, and she wants you to know that it didn't hurt that much, but now she can run really fast again. And she said, so, you know, Sharon told me, look for flashes of fur around the house. She said, but the three of them want you to know they are looking for a new Basset for you, and it's going to have properties of all three of them. It's going to be like all three rolled into one. And months later, we adopted a little Basset named Delaney, and sure enough, she reminded us of all three dogs. And I cannot imagine how in the world that she could have possibly known that. The only explanation that Sharon could have had for the fact that we lost Samantha, that we had three dogs who had died, all that means that she had to have some kind of gift that we would have to count in the realm of the supernatural. Well, I want to end up by going to Jefferson, Texas, and telling you a little bit about the Grove in Jefferson, Texas. This is my home. Tammy and I bought the house 18 years ago, and we knew that it had ghost stories associated with it, but because of my interest in the supernatural, that wasn't a plus or a minus. It was just one of those things that, yeah, that's the way it is. But we didn't originally go looking for it at all. We had just gone to Jefferson because we heard what a wonderful little getaway it was. So we booked a room at a place and we went there and we was going to eat at a restaurant called The Grove in an old home. And we went there and the restaurant was not only closed, there was a for sale sign out front. I'm like, oh, okay, we missed the opportunity to eat here. But we stood out in the street looking at it, and it was just drawing us to it. There was something about it that made an incredible impression on us. So next time we went back to Jefferson, we actually got a real estate agent to show it to us. We walked through the house, and we thought, no, we can't do this. No, this doesn't make any sense. We spent a full year trying to talk ourselves out of buying the Grove, and we're not able to do so. A year later, we closed on the house, and that's been 18 years ago. People ask me all the time, is it scary to live at the Grove? And I say, no, that's not scary at all. What's scary is how fast 18 years goes by. It's like that. I mean, don't blink, because it goes quick. That bothers me a little bit. But we have a lot of interesting things that happen there. So I wanted to just share a couple of them with you. Probably one of my favorite stories was one that the guy from the restaurant told us, Patrick. We were first looking at the house, and the restaurant guy, he was showing us. Patrick's a great guy and a great friend now. But he was taking us through and telling us some of the ghost stories. And he said one night at the restaurant, they were having a dinner theater, you know, where you do a play while you're serving the meal. And they were rehearsing the play. It was a full dress rehearsal of an old-fashioned play called Gaslight. So everybody was in period costume. And the lighting technician had her lighting board set right out here on the front porch. And the blinds were open so that she could watch inside and work the lights as the play progressed. But her board wouldn't take up space in the dining room. Well, she happened to look over. She saw a lady in a long white dress walking beside the house. She assumed it was one of the actresses because it was an old-fashioned dress. So she hollered at her. She said, excuse me, you're going the wrong way. The woman just kept walking. The actress thought, well, how weird. So she called to her again. She said, lady, there's no door on that side of the house. You're going the wrong way. The woman just kept walking. Well, this intrigued the lighting tech enough that she walked over to the railing. She leaned over. She tried to get this lady's attention one more time. She said, lady, I'm trying to tell you. And about that time, the woman stepped up through a wall. Well, inside the house, don't forget they were rehearsing a play, we have a staircase in the house that goes up to the attic. And it has a landing, and there was an actress standing on the landing getting ready to make her grand entrance in the play. And she's up there. She happens to look into the game room now. It used to be the original master bedroom to the house. And she saw a lady in a long white dress walking across the room. She crossed the stairwell in front of her, going for the room on the other side. And the actress thought she knew everybody in the play, but here was a stranger. As she went by, the actress said, excuse me, are you supposed to be here? The restaurant's closed for the evening. The woman just ignored her, went into the far room. The actress thought, well, how rude. So she goes down the stairs, goes into the far room to find out who this is, gets in there, and the house is empty. I mean, the room is empty. There's no other way in or out of that room. That was the only door, and no one was inside. She realized what she must have seen. She goes running back up front where everybody else is. You're not going to believe what I just saw. You're not going to believe what I just saw. At the same time, that lighting technician from the front porch comes bursting through the front door. You're not going to believe what I just saw. You're not going to believe what I just saw. And they saw two halves of the same thing. They saw a lady walk beside the house, step up through that wall, and walk across the width of the house. Now, like I said, Patrick told me that story, and he had told me, yeah, there's a lot of ghost stories with the house, a lot of weird things happen around here. I'm like, okay, right on, that's fine. But why would a spirit be stepping up through some random wall? Yeah, I don't get that. That makes no sense to me at all. So I just let it go. But we did buy the house. And it wasn't long till we began having our own experiences with her. And that's when I started doing research in the house, on the house. And I found that the house originally, in 1861, when it was built, stopped in the middle of that room. That's where the back of the house was. So it's probably that she is not stepping up through a wall. It's much more likely she's stepping up onto a back porch that was there when she was alive, coming through a door in what used to be a wall, going across to what was once the children's bedroom. And if that's the case, it almost has to be the original lady of the house, Minerva Stille. She and her husband Frank made that addition in 1870, 9 years after they built the house. She is the only woman that would remember the house in that configuration. So we believe it's her. Usually when I see her, I'm in another part of the house, and there's French doors going into that room, and through the doors I'll see a lady go by. My first thought is never, a ghost. My first thought is always, somebody's in the house. Because we do have a tour home, and we advertise it as such. And, you know, a lot of people seem to think that means we're open for tours 24 hours a day. So if we're not careful to keep the front door locked, we've had people just come walking in all hours of the day and night. Well, the Grove, hey, check it out. Look at this. It made for some fairly interesting circumstances in our lives. But you know, that's always my first thought, but I'll come up and I'll find the door is locked and there's nobody there. And I'll go, wow, it must have been her. She did show up on our tour one day. My wife is our district counselor for the school system, and she had to go represent the school district, this big thing they were having down in Austin. So she was gone all weekend, and that left me all alone to get the house tour ready all by myself. And I thought, oh boy, I'll never pull this off. But I gave it my best shot. And as we're outside on the front porch at the beginning of the tour, I was already apologizing to the crowd. I was like, look, if we get in there and there's dirty clothes hanging from the backs of chairs and Diet Coke cans sitting around everywhere, it's my fault. I apologize in advance. And we made it as far as the dining room. And I was telling some of the stories from in there. A lady stopped me and said, excuse me, I thought you said your wife wasn't home. And I said, well, she's not. She's in Austin. She pointed into the next room and said, well, who's the lady that just walked across that next room? I said, well, there's nobody else in the house. And I thought about it for a second. And I said, wait a minute. What was she wearing? She said, I don't know. Long white dress. I said, ah, wait till we get in there. I got a pretty cool story to tell you. Well, I can show you a few pictures of the Grove. That's our parlor. And that is the family room. It's been used by families all through the years. So it's had all these years of family love and togetherness in there. And that's why the things that happen in this room are the way they are. The things that happen in this room are very, very fun and mischievous. For example, we both love to read, and we were reading one evening. I was in my rocking chair, Tammy was on the couch, and the lamp in the corner that you can't see back over on the left side was the only light on in the house. So we're just quietly turning pages in our books, when suddenly the lamp goes click, turns itself off, leaving us in total darkness. So I found it, click, turned it back on. I said, would you guys stop that? We're going to bed soon. They did. But even on the tour, we've had a lot of things happen in this room. We've had people get tapped on the shoulder, get their hair pulled, or hear their name called from out in the hallway there. Probably the most embarrassing thing that happened in this room happened during a candlelight tour of homes one year. And that's a big thing in Jefferson. Every Christmas, there's a candlelight tour of homes, and four homes are chosen to open their doors to the public. And you buy one ticket, you get to tour all four homes. And so it's a really interesting time, and we were honored one year to be asked to be one of the four homes. So we're getting ready, and we've put out Christmas decorations, and we've got the house all lit by candlelight. We're really just loving the way it looks. We were anxious to share it with everybody, but I was writing scripts for our friends who were going to be docents, because in every room during the candlelight tour, there's a docent in period costume to tell you the history of the house as you go through. So I was writing the scripts for our friends, and my wife had a great idea. She said, look, we're going to be on this tour with three other homes. They're not going to be telling ghost stories. They're just going to be telling their history. For once in our life, can we be like everybody else? And I said, yeah, it's a good idea. So we left out our ghost stories. We only told the history of our house for the first two weekends in December that year. And it was a great tour. We had like 3,000 people come through the house. It was an amazing time. But it's on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday nights. And they do that at night so that the candlelight shows up. So Sunday morning of the first weekend, we went downtown to have breakfast. We went to a place called the bakery, and we're sitting at a table eating breakfast. And this couple comes over to us, and the lady said, excuse me, do y'all own the Grove? And I said, yeah, we do. She said, I thought I recognized you guys. We toured your house last night on the candlelight tour of homes. And they pointed out the owners. I thought that looked like y'all. I said, that was us. Hope you had a good time. Appreciate you coming. She said, we did. Is your house haunted? And I thought, oh boy, what now? I said, well, we do have our share of ghost stories, I guess. Why? And she said, well, we had pulled up out front, and there was a line to get in, so we went and got in line with all these other strangers that had come about the same time we did, and, you know, they're letting in 10 or 15 people at a time to go through the house, so we got to go through with all these other folks, and we went from room to room, heard all the stories and everything. We got all the way back to the den, to this new room, and she said, I'm just standing there listening to the docent over by the Christmas tree tell the history of that part of the house, and as I'm standing there, all of a sudden, I felt somebody pop me on the bottom. She said, and I looked, and my husband was across the room, and I thought, oh, it's one of these strangers. One of these strangers has touched my bottom. She goes, boy, I was going to slap somebody silly, but nobody was anywhere near me. I said, I am so sorry. Oh, I was just horrified. As soon as we finished eating, we went straight home. I came directly into the den here. I said, no, that cannot happen. You must respect the ladies. Thankfully, that's never happened again. Although I did have a group of the, what do you call them, the red hat ladies on the tour one time, and I was telling them that story, and they were all, ooh, can't we suspend that rule for one day? I'm like, no, don't encourage this. And then in closing, my final favorite story from the Grove came from, we'd only lived there, I guess it was the first year, and we hadn't redone our kitchen. So there was an old stove in there, and I don't mean old like in antique. I mean old like in beat up and well used. It had been used for the restaurant, but it was a modern stove, and it was a gas stove. So we had been invited to a party, and Tammy said, "What are we going to bring?" And I said, "Let's bring chicken wings. I love chicken wings." So I went to the store. I got all the ingredients, and I marinated them overnight in the fridge. I was making three different kinds, some lemon pepper wings and some bourbon wings and some cola wings, believe it or not. So I went by, and I turned the oven on to preheat, and I got the wings, and I was putting them on the trays to bake on. And I do bake our wings instead of deep frying them. Somehow I've convinced myself that that makes them healthy. But anyway, I opened the door to the oven to put them in, and it was cold inside. And I thought, what in the world? You know, the oven stopped working. Oh, no, how are we going to cook? How we're going to have to go to the party empty-handed. And we were still kind of new in Jefferson, so I was feeling pretty bad about this. And I thought, oh, no. So we had been working on the gas, and I thought, well, we did have the gas turned off. I wonder if there's a pilot light that didn't get turned back on. So I got down on my hands and knees, and I opened the bottom door where the pilot light was, and the smell of gas nearly knocked me over. I was like, whoa, man. Now, most stoves have a special feature that if the pilot light is not lit, gas won't flow. Well, in this stove, either that had been long broken or disabled or something, because I had been pumping this bottom chamber full of gas. And I thought, okay, I've got to light this pilot light. But, you know, here I am on the floor looking back in here, and I'm not really proud of my next thought. But my next thought was, I'll bet if I could get one of these wand lighters back there quick enough, I could light that pilot light and we could cook the wings and we could go. Well, it was, you know, of course, dark under there. So I went and found a flashlight and I got one of these lighters, clicked it. Yeah, it's working. So I got down on my hands and knees. I put the lighter on the shelf on the island behind me, and I got the flashlight and I turned it on, and I was looking for the jet where the pilot light was, and I got it lined up. I said, okay. So I reached back to get the lighter and it wasn't there. So I turned around. It was nowhere to be seen. So I thought, well, I know I put it right here. So I stood up, I walked around the kitchen, nothing. I even started walking around the house looking for it. My wife saw me. She says, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm looking for this wand lighter. I was going to light the stove. It's, you know, the gas jet wasn't lit for the pilot to be on. So, you know, now it's just full of gas." And she said, "And you were going to light it?" And I'm like, "Well, I'm sorry. Okay. We'll figure something out, but help me find this lighter." Well, long story short, never found the lighter. I mean, we had to go to the party. So Tammy had a great idea. She said, "All right, wait for that gas to dissipate. Get a candle, a taper candle, light the end of it, and use that to light the pilot light." I was like, "Brilliant. That's great. We'll do that." So I did that. The gas had all gone out. Everything was fine. We cooked the wings. We went to the party. Great success. Oh, fast forward a couple of months, and we have a long buffet up front where we keep dishes and things in, and we had some friends coming over. So Tammy was setting the table, putting out some dishes, and I was back in the kitchen, and I heard her say, "Mitch, better come here." So I walked up there. I was like, "Yeah, what is it?" She had opened the door, and on the stack of dishes was that lighter. Now, we hadn't opened the door to the buffet because we weren't entertaining much. We were still kind of working on the house, so that door hadn't been opened since probably we stuck the dishes in there months before. I have no idea how it got back there, but, you know, I told Tammy, I was like, "I bet if we had some way of peering into the supernatural world, that they've got a big board up there, a big whiteboard, and they've divided up, all the spirits have divided up the times. You watch this idiot from here to here, and you watch him from here, you know, he nearly blew the house up. Somebody's got to keep an eye on this guy." Well, thankfully, nothing bad has happened. We've really had a wonderful time living there. And so with that, I will close and see, do we have any questions from the group?
Have a number of questions for you.
Okay.
How did you get into researching true ghost stories?
So, and that's actually a really good question, and I've got something to say about that. True ghost stories, the things that really happened to me are fascinating. I mean, they're the idea that life goes on after we die, that there's another whole dimension to this world that we don't see. Now, the thing to differentiate is those true ghost stories from the kind of things you see on the movies. You know, the things you see on the movies are like Poltergeist, and there was one about the Winchester Mystery House called Winchester, you know, and they're terrible, terrible, you know, I mean, entertaining, don't get me wrong, but they're terrible representations of real life. And all the time that I have been writing about these places and visiting them, I've never had anything bad happen other than the time I got scared, and that was just me being scared, okay. But you have to differentiate the real versus the fiction. And all the places I've written about, let's take Winchester House, for example. It's in California, in San Jose. They made this horror movie about it, you know, where people are getting killed and running out in fright and all like this. But if you look at it today, it's a big tour home. So they have a staff of tour guides that do the tours. They have a restaurant, so you've got wait staff and cooks and people that, you know, ring up when you leave. They've got a big a gift shop where you can buy everything from a t-shirt to a coffee mug with a Winchester logo on it. So you have all this staff that goes and clocks in every day and clocks out at the end of the day. I've been there a number of times. I've had the opportunity to talk to some of these folks, and they all say the same thing. It's like, yeah, weird things happen around here, but it's nothing scary. It's just kind of odd, you know, and they go on about their business. And that's really the way it is. So for me, looking at these places, I'm not looking for sensational horror stories. You know, I'm actually looking for people's real experiences. And the more I got into the process of writing books about these places, the more I realized that the things that happen are truly fascinating. They're wonderful, but they're nothing like you're ever going to see in the movies.
Another question that's come in: which unexpected small Texas towns or cities have the best stories or the creepiest history we should know about?
Well, okay, so of course I'm going to say Jefferson. But I say that because Jefferson was once a river port. It was one of the largest ports into Texas. I think it was second to Galveston. So you had people coming to Texas, to this new world, to earn their fortune. And you had gamblers, and you had gunfighters, and you had floozies, and then you had businessmen. And so it was all this emotion churning up in this town. I think a lot of that is left over. It's amazing to me all the ghost stories we have in Jefferson. We have hotels that are haunted and B&Bs that are haunted. But the most interesting thing about Jefferson to me is, everybody knows I live at the Grove. Everybody knows I live in a haunted place. Everybody knows I'm just kind of cool about it, you know, no big deal. So they don't have a problem telling me their stories. Well, they would never tell anybody else what happens in their store or what happens in their home. You know, they'll get me off to the side and go, I got to tell you this. You can't tell anybody, but here's what happened to me. And I literally have heard stories from most of the shops downtown, things that happened. Only a few I can talk about. So it's an interesting place to live, but it's even more interesting to hear the haunted history of.
Thank you. The best North Texas road trips for the creepy history or ghost tours?
Depending on what you mean by road trip, there's a place not far from here called Goatman's Bridge. And the story of the Goatman has got a lot of different elements to it. And you can look it up online. It's very well documented.
Do you remember where it is?
Yeah, it's up toward, what is north on 35?
35?
Yeah.
Gainesville?
No, Denton.
Denton.
Yeah, it's up toward Denton. And it actually shows up on Google Maps, believe it or not. But that is an interesting place because it's got a lot of history that is, to some people, unsettling. I've been there. I put it in my Ghost of North Texas Revisited book, the second edition I did of it. And we thought it was a wonderful old place. It's a bridle trail now, but it's beautiful. And it's an old, old bridge that they've maintained. So if I had to go somewhere just for the scenery and for the stories, I would go to Goatman's Bridge up near Denton.
Another question has been submitted that I'll probably have to help you with. And that is creepy Allen hauntings or any haunting in Allen. And the answer is yes, but because some of the areas are residential now, they weren't then, they were along Rowlett Creek, there's some stories. And then along the old Greenville Avenue, which was the old Highway 75, but is now Greenville Avenue, which goes from Allen to McKinney and to Sherman and then down to Dallas.
Let me write these down.
Yeah, there were some stories that happened along the stage routes, and there's some other structures in Allen, but I, because of the security issue, I don't want to mention them right now. But yes, there are some places we do have our stories, and
we'll be getting together later and talking a little bit more about that.
And I want to thank Mitchell for coming to us tonight.
My pleasure.
And we're going to show a slide as we close where you can buy some of his books. And we thank you so much for coming tonight. And
thanks for the invitation.
Hope you have a good evening.
I really enjoyed it. You guys have been great.
Thank you.